Thank you. Okay. So first, let me fix a couple of notation. So in this talk, P will be a prime number. So for the moment, P is any prime number, but later I will assume that P is different from 2. But for a start, for the moment, P is an arbitrary prime number. So let us fix E over F, a separable quadratic extension of periodic field, or more generally of a locally compact non-Archimedean fields of residue characteristic P. And I will denote by G the group GLNE, and by H the closed subgroup GLNF, which is the subgroup of G who's made of those elements which are invariant under the Galois involution. So here, sigma is the non-trivial element of the Galois group of E over F. And the goal this talk is to study the irreducible smooth complex representations of G, which are distinguished by H. So what does it mean to be distinguished by H? So if you denote by pi an irreducible representation of G, so which acts on a complex vector space V. So first, let me recall that smooth means that the stabilizer in G of any vector of the vector space is an open subgroup in G. And distinguished means that so pi is distinguished by H if V carries a non-zero H invariant linear form. So it is a linear form phi from V to C such that for all H in H and all V in the vector space V, phi of pi H V is equal to phi of V. And I will denote by home sub H pi C the space of such H invariant linear forms. So this situation is a part of a wider program, which is sometimes called the relative Lagrange program. Aiming at classifying irreducible representations of a reductive periodic group G, which are distinguished by G sigma for some involution sigma on G. And at least conjecturally, those distinguished representations are expected related to another group, so to are expected to come from another periodic group G prime via a Langlands functorial transfer. So for instance, if I go back to my initial situation, if G is GLNE and H is so G sigma, which is GLNF, then in that case, for that pair, G prime is the quasi-split unitary group in n variables defined with respect to the quadratic extension E over F. And the Langlands functorial transfer from G prime to G is one of the Bayes changes from the unitary group to GLNE. Now let pi be some irreducible complex representations, a representation of G. So now G in the G is GLNE, H is GLNF throughout the talk. So let pi be some irreducible representation of G. Then it has a central character. Denoted omega pi, so which is a character of the center of G, which identifies naturally to the multiplicative group of E, and which tells you how the center E star acts on V through the representation pi. And if you look at the definition of being distinguished, then it follows that if pi is distinguished by H, then the central character of pi must be distinguished by the central by the center of H, which means that omega pi is trivial on the center of H, which identifies with F times. It gives you a first easy necessary condition for being distinguished. And there is another one, which is due to Flicker and Prasad. So if pi is a complex irreducible representation of G, which is H distinguished, and then its contragradient which I will denote by pi chesh is isomorphic to its conjugate representation, which is so the conjugate of pi by sigma, which is just pi composed with the Galois involution sigma on the group G. And moreover, in that case, when one is in this conjugate situation where pi is distinguished, in that case, the space of H invariant linear forms on pi has dimension one as a complex vector space. So this gives us two necessary conditions for an irreducible representation pi to be distinguished. And it is natural to ask whether these two conditions are also sufficient. So the first condition is this one. And the second condition is this one. So, let me make a remark and assume for a moment, for a couple of minutes, replace the quadratic extension of periodic fields E over F by a quadratic extension of finite field. So a quadratic extension of finite fields. So F Q square over F Q. You may ask the same question. The notion of being distinguished is well defined, and these two necessary conditions are still necessary conditions in the finite field case. And it is a result of Roderick Gau that these two conditions, and actually the second one is enough, are necessary and sufficient conditions for being distinguished. So by an irreducible complex representation of GLN FQ square is distinguished by GLN FQ if and only if pi Cech is contragradient is isomorphic to pi sigma. So what happens to the first condition? You will notice that the first condition is implied by the second one, because in the finite field case, the norm map from FQ square to FQ is surjective. Now, if we go back to the non-Archimedean situation, where E over F is a quadratic extension of periodic field, then in that case, the norm map is not surjective, which makes the situation more complicated. So if you consider the norm map, so now I go back to the periodic case. So you consider the norm map from E times to F times, it is not surjective, and I will denote by eta the unique character of F whose kernel is exactly the image of the norm map. So in particular, it is a quadratic character. Quadratic in the sense that eta square is trivial. Eta is non-trivial by definition, anyway. So if pi is irreducible and satisfies pi Cech isomorphic to pi sigma, then what can you say about its central character? If you restrict it to F times, it is either trivial or equal to this character eta. Okay, so what about if pi satisfies both 1 and 2, is it enough for being distinguished? So the answer is no in general. And if we specify to irreducible representations, which are discrete series representations, we have the following theorem, which is due to Cable and Anandavardhanan Cable Tandon. Which tells you that, so maybe suppose that the characteristic of F is not 2. Let pi be a discrete series representation of G, such that pi Cech is isomorphic to pi sigma. Then pi is either H distinguished or eta distinguished. I will explain what it means, but not both at the same time. So eta distinguished means that the vector space of linear forms which transform via the character eta composed with a determinant through H is non-zero. So this theorem can be called the dichotomy disjunction theorem. So the dichotomy part is this part. If pi satisfies pi chesh isomorphic to pi sigma, then pi is either distinguished or eta distinguished. And the disjunction part tells you that it cannot be both at the same time. So now we would like to know in which case we are. So if pi is a discrete series representation which satisfies this condition, how can we say when it is distinguished and when it is eta distinguished? So I have only assumed that pi chesh is isomorphic to pi sigma. I did not make any assumption on the central character here. So what if I add the assumption that the central character is trivial? It is not always enough to conclude. It depends on the parity of n. So, corollary, if n is odd, then it is sufficient to conclude. Then a discrete series representation pi is distinguished if and only if pi chesh is isomorphic to pi sigma and the central character of pi is trivial on f times. It follows, it is an easy consequence of the fact that if pi chesh is isomorphic to pi sigma, then and if pi is eta distinguished, then the central character of pi restricted to f times is equal to eta to the power of n. So if n is odd, the central character will be non-trivial, and so it will contradict the assumption. What if n is even? If n is even, is it possible to find a necessary and sufficient condition of distinction for a discrete series representation? So the first step, it is possible to reduce to the cuspidal case. So the reduction step is due to Alain Vardanyan Matringe. Again, suppose that the characteristic of F is not 2. So, in order to find a necessary and sufficient condition of distinction for a discrete series representation pi of G, it is enough to do it for cuspidal representations. So, yes. In the corollary. So, this is a general fact, independent of the parity of n. So, if pi is eta distinguished, then this is the formula for the central character of eta. So, if you assume that n is odd, eta square is trivial. So if n is odd, eta to the n will be equal to eta. But you assume that this. So pi cannot be eta distinguished, and if it is not eta distinguished, it must be distinguished. So in the case when pi is cuspidal, representation of G, the local Langlands correspondence associates to pi, and it's a Langlands parameter, which is an irreducible n-dimensional representation phi pi of the Weyl group of F. And so at least when the characteristic of F is zero, or maybe different from two is enough, there is a necessary and a sufficient condition of distinction of pi stated in terms of its Langlands parameter phi pi. But the local Langlands correspondence is not transparent. It is not. It is not completely. It is not explicit. And one would like to find a more intrinsic criterion on the cuspidal representation pi. So what does it mean, a more intrinsic criterion? So we just not appeal to the local Langlands correspondence. So it is known for GLN that cuspidal representations can be described by the compact induction process. So it is due to Bushnell and Kutsko. Given a cuspidal irreducible representation pi of G, there are a compact mod center subgroup J of G and an irreducible representation lambda of J, such that the compact induction of lambda from J to G is isomorphic to pi. And so Bushnell and Kutsko are even more specific, even more precise than that. It is not only a statement of existence, they construct explicitly the pairs J lambda, which are called the type, which have such a property and which allow one to construct cuspidal representations by compact induction. Okay, now if one is interested, if one starts from this formula, and if one is interested in determining whether or not pi is distinguished, by a simple application of the Mackey formula, we get the following: home H pi C is decomposes as a product of spaces home H intersect J G lambda G C, where G runs over the double cosets mod J. So there are infinitely many double cosets, but if you look at I erased it. If you look at the theorem by Flicker and Prasad, there is a multiplicity one statement. This space has dimension at most one. So this product is actually a direct sum, and there is at most one double coset which contributes to the distinction of pi. So there is at most one double coset G which contributes to the distinction of pi. So the general idea is, thanks to the knowledge that we have on J and lambda, to study for each double coset the contribution of each vector space. So one has the following partial results. The first results are in the what is called the essentially time case. So essentially time is an assumption on the cuspidal representation. So pi is cuspidal. And we consider the set of characters from G to C times, which are unramified and such that pi twisted by chi remains isomorphic to pi. So this is known to be a finite set, and I will denote by T of pi its cardinality. It is a torsion, it is an invariant associated to pi, it is its torsion number. And essentially time means that n over T of f, so it is a T of pi, so it is a general fact that T of pi is a divisor of n. And essentially time means that this integer is prime to pi. And it can be shown that it, in terms of the Langlands parameter of pi, it is equivalent to the fact that if you consider the Langlands parameter of pi and if you restrict it to the wild inertia subgroup, PF, then it decomposes as a sum of one-dimensional representations. And in that case, essentially time cuspidal representation pi can be parametrized by objects which are simpler than the Bushnell-Kuskow type, which are called admissible pairs or Ho pairs. By admissible or Ho pairs. And Hakim and Murnaghan gave, so when p is not 2, so from now on in the talk, p will be different from 2. So so when p is not 2, they give sufficient condition on an essentially time cuspidal representation pi for pi to be distinguished by H. So they only give sufficient condition, if you add, so by the result from Anand, Cable, and Tandon, you can deduce that this sufficient condition is also a necessary condition. This result by Hakim and Murnaghan, I think it is 2002. And there is a more recent result by Coniglio, 2016. She gives a necessary and sufficient condition of distinction for pi cuspidal of level 0. So of level 0 is a condition which is stronger than being essentially tame. If the cuspidal has level 0, then it must be essentially tame. So the condition is stronger, but she gets a necessary and sufficient condition independently of the dichotomy and disjunction result by Ananda Vardhanan Cable Thompson. So the argument is purely local, and so independent of AKT. And again, so P is not 2. Okay. So now the main result I would like to talk about in this talk is generalization of Coniglio's result. So when P is not 2, but which gives a necessary and insufficient condition for any cuspidal representation. So no conditions of the level, no condition of tameness. Any cuspidal representation, the only assumption is that P is not 2. And give, so when P is not 2, a necessary and sufficient condition of distinction for any cuspidal representation pi of G. So here are a couple of remarks. The first remark, this is done by using Bushnell-Kutzko's type theory. So when the cuspidal representation is not assumed to be essentially tame, you cannot consider admissible pair. It is not enough. You have to parameterize your cuspidal representation by a Bushnell-Kutzko's type, which, from a technical point of view, is more complicated than an admissible pair. The second remark is that the method is purely local. Purely local, so which means that there is no global result involved. There is no automorphic form. There is no trace formula. As for Coniglio, it does not use the dichotomy, the disjunction property. And a third remark is that it also works when one replaces the field of complex numbers by a field of positive characteristics, so say by FL bar. So an algebraic closure of some finite field of characteristic L with L different from P. But if you replace C by FL bar, and if you consider smooth L modular representations, in that case, there is a difference between cuspidal and supercuspidal. A supercuspidal representation is always cuspidal, but there are examples of cuspidal representations which are not supercuspidal. And in that case, this necessary and sufficient criterion works only for supercuspidal, so mod L representations of G. I will say more about it in the last part of my talk. The cuspidal, non-supercuspidal case is much more difficult to consider. And in particular, there are counterexamples to the dichotomy theorem. There are cuspidal representations such that pi sigma is isomorphic to pi church, but which are nor distinguished nor eta distinguished. I will come back to it later. So here is the statement of the main theorem. So again, suppose that P is not 2. So when P is 2, the method doesn't work at all. And let pi be a cuspidal irreducible complex representation of G such that pi church is isomorphic to pi sigma. Then first part of the theorem associated to this pi, there are two objects. The first one is a tamely ramified extension k of e of degree dividing n together with an f involution extending sigma, and second a quadratic character denoted nu of the multiplicative group of T, where T is the fixed point subfield of K by sigma. So you have the following diagram. You have E over F, which is quadratic. K over E is tamely ramified, and T, so K over T is again quadratic, and T over F also, of course, is tamely ramified. So T is K sigma, and F, of course, is E sigma. And the distinction criterion for P is stated in terms of this quadratic character nu. So here is the second part of the theorem. Suppose, moreover, that the central character of pi is trivial on F, then pi, then so, first case, if E over F is ramified, if the ramification index of T over F is even, and if K over T is unramified, then pi is distinguished if and only if the quadratic character nu is non-trivial, and in the remaining case, pi is distinguished if and only if the character nu is trivial. So it is this quadratic character nu whose construction follows from the Bushnell-Kutzkos theory of types, which tells you whether or not your cuspidal representation is distinguished or either distinguished. So this this invariant, this quadratic character nu, it is finer than the central character. It gives you more information than the central character, at least when n is even. When n is odd, it is enough to know the central character. What time is it? Okay, now I would like to say a word about the modular case. So now replace the field of complex number by FL bar, say, right? With L different from P. So it can be any algebraically closed field of characteristic different from P, of characteristic L different from P, but let's assume it is just FL bar. Doesn't matter. The important assumption is that L is not P. Okay, so in this setting, you have a notion of a smooth representation. The definition is the same as in the complex case. You have a notion of a cuspidal representation, and you have a notion of supercuspidal representation. So what is the difference? For complex representations, cuspidal and supercuspidal are known to be equivalent. I give you the definition. So first, cuspidal. So what does it mean? So if pi is irreducible FL bar representation of G, then pi is cuspidal if and only if pi does not embed in a parabolically induced representation. And pi is supercuspidal if and only if pi does not occur as a subquotient of a proper parabolically induced representation. Yes. So supercuspidal always implies cuspidal, but in the modular case, the converse need not be true. I give you a counterexample. So if G is G L2E, and so consider V the space of locally constant functions on G mod B. So you may think, so B is the standard Borel subgroup made of upper triangular matrices. So G mod B, you may think of it as the projective line over E with the natural action of G by homographies. So this is some parabolically induced, you consider functions with values in FL bar. So this is parabolically induced. And in the complex case, this representation V is known to have a length 2. It is indecomposable. The unique irreducible subspace is the space of constant functions, which carries the trivial character. And the unique irreducible quotient is the Steinberg representation. If L divides Q plus 1, QE plus 1, where QE is the cardinality of the residue field of E, then V has no longer length 2, but V has length 3. with irreducible, so it is indecomposable with irreducible sub representation of the trivial character, with irreducible quotient. The following unramified character, so it is the absolute value of the determinant of G. Notice that this character has order at most 2 because Q has order at most 2 modulo L. And the remaining subquotient is irreducible. It is irreducible, but it is cuspidal. And you deduce that it is cuspidal by computing the Jacquet module of V. As in the complex case, the Jacquet module of V has length 2. So the trivial character contributes with a one-dimensional factor in the Jacquet module. The character of order 2 contributes with another one-dimensional character in the Jacquet module, and so the remaining subquotient has a trivial Jacquet module, so it is cuspidal. Okay. What happens to this theorem in the mod L case for supercuspidal representations? So, theorem. This one is theorem one. This one will be theorem two. Let pi be a supercuspidal FL bar representation of the group G, such that pi sigma is isomorphic to pi chesh. First case, if L is different from 2, then the necessary and sufficient condition of theorem 1 still holds. And if L is equal to 2, then if L equals 2, there is no non-trivial quadratic character. So if L equals 2, in which case there is no non-trivial quadratic character. So in particular, there is no analog for the character denoted eta. Then the criterion of distinction simplifies, and it tells you that pi is distinguished if and only if pi sigma is isomorphic to pi chesh. So there is no dichotomy because there is no eta in the L equals 2 case. Yes. So the yes. So in the modular case, there is still a theory of types, which extends the complex case, and so supercuspidal and even cuspidal representations can be obtained via compact inductions of types, and as in the complex case, you can use this description via type theory to reduce your distinction problem to a problem in the finite group case. And so when the representation is cuspidal, is a supercuspidal, it works as in the complex case, but when the representation is cuspidal, non-supercuspidal, even in the finite field case, there are problems which are not solved yet. So what if pi is cuspidal, non-supercuspidal? So mod L, of course. So as I said earlier, there are cuspidal representations pi of G, such that pi sigma is isomorphic to pi Cech, which are neither distinguished nor eta distinguished. And I can give you an example of this phenomenon. So suppose again that G is GL2E and that the quadratic extension E over F is unramified. And let pi be a cuspidal representation of G such that pi sigma is isomorphic to pi Cech. So first case if pi is supercuspidal. So if pi is supercuspidal, then as has been stated in theorem one, pi is distinguished if and only if the quadratic character nu, which is associated to it, is trivial. Second case, if pi is cuspidal, non-supercuspidal, and L is different from 2, then in this case, pi is nor distinguished, neither distinguished nor eta distinguished. And in the remaining case, so if pi is cuspidal, non-supercuspidal, and if L is 2, then pi is always distinguished. So the third case, the third example is due to Rob Korintsuk and Matrange. Okay, I'll stop here. Thank you.